Well, we've shipped out the first of the slip sliders. That's the harmonica I'm holding in my hand. You can see the bottom reed plate is moving to the left or the right, depending on how I move my hand. It's a harmonica in two halves. And there's been a lot of questions and a lot of reaction on harmonica chat groups and people asking various things about the slip slider. So in this video, I want to try and answer some of the questions and also explore a little bit more the playing side of the slip slider, including how to get chromatic scales and just some of the things I've discovered in the last week since fooling around with it. And also playing amplified with a microphone. So I'll get started. Well, one of the most common questions about the slip slider is, how can a harmonica that is actually comes in two halves and just is held together with magnets, how can it be airtight? It's a good question. I mean, when I look behind from the slip slider, I can see light through the harmonica in certain places, little slivers of light. And so, I mean, it's, you know, the obvious thing is, how can a harmonica that where you can see light through it can be airtight? But in actual practice and playing, it sounds pretty good. To me, it sounds like a normal out-of-the-box harmonica. And there's a couple of reasons for that. One, the more you play, moisture from your breath builds up between the two halves. And there's tiny little gaps there, but moisture from your breath, there's a thing called capillary attraction or capillary action. You've probably seen it, you know, if you, there's a tiny droplet of water on a piece of glass and you put a thin piece of plastic sheet on it, the water will spread out and, move to between the two. And in fact, it's quite hard to pull them apart sometimes. So the more you play, moisture from your breath is going inside the harmonica and it's actually building up on the two halves there. And especially when it's cold, you can really see this on the two halves. It's not that cold in the room at the moment. But it builds up, and through capillary attraction, it gets drawn to the gaps, you know, in the two places. The other thing, apart from the two magnets that are holding it together, and these magnets, by the way, are 1 kilo each of pull, your hands are also holding it together. So as you hold the instrument, you're actually pressing the two halves together. And especially in the slip sliding action, there's quite a lot of pressure sideways, but also, you know, up and down between your finger and thumb. So that's helping hold it together. Now, you can enhance the air tightness if you want in various ways. You could go back to the early days of the marine band and just dip your harp in water, which I remember doing when I first started playing with the old pearwood combs. You do get a short-term gain with that. The other thing you can do if you don't have any water is just add some natural liquid, you know, lick the parts and with, you know, and you've got natural saliva. I mean, I do find that really, I can hear a noticeable difference straight away there. So that's an easy thing you can do anywhere. The other thing you could do is use some substances like chromatic harmonica slide oil. Just apply them to the two parts. That's a non-toxic slide oil that they use for chromatic harmonicas. And also things like petroleum jelly, like Vaseline. You can just dab Vaseline on one of the sides or both sides, and that'll help fill any gaps. So those are things you can do. Personally, I find that just playing them, as long as the two halves are flat, as flat as you can get by eye, then the tiny little gaps in between them do get filled with moisture from your breath. Now, you might be able to see these little raised dimples here on each cover plate. We supply these with the slip slider, and they just help to give your fingers some grip on the covers. So the top finger would go on that one, my thumb on that one, and it just helps you grip the covers when you're moving. So this is the to get the blow bending. This is the movement you'll be doing, and then where you're dragging your top finger to the left and pushing your thumb to the right. So you can pretty much, there's your normal holding position, and then you just do that. And then for the draw bends, it's the opposite. This is a little bit more awkward. So it's a little bit more awkward. You can actually help hold it with your right hand fingers like that, if you want to just assist with holding that position, or just assist. So those are the two movements, and a little bit of extra grip on the covers does help. We also supply some tape strips which you can put on the covers as well, and that's where my finger goes. So that just gives a little bit of extra grip. So you can have, you can use a combination. You could even have the tape plus a dot like that. That's quite interesting. But these things will help if you're in a sweaty situation and it's you know, you're finding that your fingers are slipping on the instrument because the magnets are fairly strong. Now, when you first get your slip slider, what I'd recommend is first of all playing it just as a normal harp. You know, you just get used to it, and then first of all go into the blow bending position. So this is one where you move your finger, your top finger, back a bit and brace with your thumb, and the draw plate moves to the right. Okay, the draw plate shifts to the right. So it's really easy and intuitive kind of playing. So. That seven blow is really fantastic to have. Okay, so you just basically hold that position and blow bend everything. And of course you've also got that blow bend on hold two in the bottom octave. Now it's quite interesting, we're not used to bending blow notes down there, and how you shape your embouchure makes a big difference. Just have a listen. So if I can actually get a nasty sound if I have too big an embouchure. Okay, that's kind of like the embouchure I'd use with the draw bend. I seem to need a big embouchure. If I have that same embouchure on the blow bend, it adopts this horrible sort of you know, warbling sound. You have to use a smaller embouchure. It's almost like a high blow bend. So you just got to slightly adjust and you know, learn how to do these low blow bends, which are kind of a new thing to us. But anyway, you can actually, once you get the feel for them, you can use them in nice little licks, like a little common turnaround. Okay, now that's a kind of a nice little, you know, blues end. Yeah. Okay, so that's just me going and then pushing. Now I find it's best to adopt the pushed position on the natural blow note and then bend it down rather than go, because then you're trying to coordinate two things, your blow bend and the slide push at the same time. So instead go. And you can develop that one a bit more. Okay, so actually, let's try that lick in the middle octave. There's different ways you could play that lick. So here's one way. If you watch the slip slider and you can see the movement as I go. I could also just hold the slip slider in for the first, you know, for the bulk of the lick. Because my five draw is now on six blow hole. So in some ways that's easier because you're not moving so much. So now moving to the draw position. This is where you move your thumb back and push your top finger forward. This is really cool. Basically what it does is it moves the draw reeds to the left. So eight draw suddenly moves down to seven draw, okay? And that's really cool because you get the eight draw note in the seventh hole, and it's right next to the sixth draw note. And you can do some very cool sort of third position kind of licks. So here's your eight draw, which you can now bend, and it's right next to six draw. This is a C harp, so that's like a D to an A. And there's your high draw, which is like six draw. Now other people have said, can you play chromatically on it? Yes, you can. It's fully chromatic now through bends alone if you want to. You can still overblow. If you are used to that technique and you want to use it, you can still do it. Again, if you know, it's best to emboss the reeds and re-gap the reeds for overblowing, as on any normal harp. This one hasn't been adjusted in that way, but the overblows are there. But if you, you know, struggle with overblows, or if you want some alternative to overblows, you have every overblow note as a bent note. So here's a chromatic scale, and if you just watch the slip slider, what I'm doing as I go. So let's try that a little bit slower. There's your C, B, and there's your B flat, which is a bent note on the seven blow bend. There's your six draw A and A flat, which is six draw bend. And then to get the six blow, instead of leaving it, I immediately move the slider there because it's a nicer sound. It's that six blow that I can bend now. So I go straight to my six blow with the slider version and then bend it down for the F sharp. And that's the G to F sharp. Now I could go down to the F on hole five and then go to the slider. But I find it easier just to hold the slider in and do the F on six blow now. As opposed to, it's just a little bit less, you know, sliding action going on. It's kind of easier. Okay, so that's a chromatic scale. If you want to play it in the middle octave, let's try the top octave. So start with your in the neutral position. So C, that's your C, C, B, B flat, and then your A. I go to the slip slider straight away there. And that's A flat, and then G, F sharp. So let's try that one more time. It's possible. Now, I don't play Richter tuning myself. I gave it up decades ago. For me, I have to really think that through. But people who do play Richter tuning, like the majority of harp players, basically you can now play fully chromatic scales in Richter tuning throughout the entire harp using bending alone if you want to. And you can combine it with your overblow playing to get, you know, different flavours. So good overblow players can keep doing what they do and then hit the bends if they want to, just for a change of sound, a bit more expression on an over, you know, on a normally overblown note, etc. And the other thing is that your normal notes, the ones that you're not trying to bend or whatever, do get a lot more soul just because you can add vibrato on them. So for instance, six blow, that's the normal one. Now in the slider version, you can really add a lot of soul to it, five blow. So you can add soul, you know, vibrato and all those things to those notes, which normally you can't. You know, it's much more expressive. Same with seven blow. Okay, normally you can't do a thing with it. Now, it's a really sexy, beautiful note in its own right without, you know, worrying about the, you know, the chromatic possibilities. Same with your high draw bends. You know, here's eight draw. Okay, it's there's a note there, but you can't do anything with it. Now, you go to the slip slider. Okay, it's a lot more sexy and soulful. And here's 10 draw. Again, it's just kind of like one of those, you know, it's a note, but you can't do anything with it. With the slip slider, listen to it. That's 10 draw. Of course, it's now moved down to 9, but it's the same note. But so you can just add so much more soul and stuff to notes. Same goes, of course, with 2 blow. The slip slider. and even one blow. Now, one blow you can't bend with the slip slider, but what happens when you move your reed plate to the right, it becomes an isolated note. There's no other note in that hole. So in normal position, it's blow draw. And then when you move it to the right, you just get blow. There's no draw there. It's an isolated note. But that just means that there's no air leaking through the draw reed slot anymore. And it means you can get a lovely tone on that one blow. Put more, you know, it's louder. You can put vibrato on it. So one blow becomes a nice, you know, a more soulful and expressive note as well. Now, someone pointed out on my forum that 10 blow is also isolated. Normally, you've got 10 blow and 10 draw. Now, when you do the shift, you've got 10 on its own. So it's an isolated note, so you can sort of add valve bending to it. But you can also overdraw it and more easily than normal. Okay, so you can actually get quite a strong overdraw. And again, this is no reed gapping or anything, but it does mean that you've got that stronger overdraw on the 10 if you want it. Now, another common question has been, what's the slip slider like with a microphone? To be honest, this is my first time trying it. I've got one of Greg Heumann's fantastic bulletizer mics here. And I'm just going through my little Korg Pandora and straight into my computer speakers. So this is not a, you know, this is not a classic, you know, amplified Chicago setup by any means, but it'll give the idea. So, okay, so that's basically just playing without any movement of the slip slider. But now, holding the microphone in my hand, I can still do the action. And let's see what that sounds like. So here's two blow in normal position. And slip sliding. So let's extend that little lick a bit more. Okay, so you can hear it's pretty quiet. There's a little bit of noise, but not much. So here's a kind of just a kind of a classic blues harp loop. Okay, now when I get up to that sixth blow, I'm actually going to shift my slip slider so that I get the slid version of the sixth blow, which actually allows me to put vibrato and stuff on it. Actually, I'm sliding it on the five. And then there's that seven blow. So you can do licks like you do in the bottom. And you can move them up to the top end, or to the middle octave. Draw bend position. This is where you move your thumb back and your finger forwards. This is a little bit more awkward holding a mic, I'd say. So there's your eight draw, which is now down to hole seven. But once you're in position, it's pretty cool. Balance, I'd say that it is a little bit more awkward to hold a mic and do the slip slider action, but it could be, you know, that my particular hand position is just that more, I suppose, the classic one. Other people use other positions, sort of more like that kind of thing, so they can no doubt adjust in some way. And I mean, there is potential to actually add bits to the harmonica to help you move things around if you wanted to. I'm just using a bit of tape and a little dot there. But who knows what people will come up with as they get out there into the wild. And, you know, sort of lots of brains get applied to the task of, you know, finding the best way of holding and moving things around on the slip slider. I'm really looking forward to getting the feedback from people and hearing, you know, reports of things they've tried, for instance, different kinds of grip tape, maybe, to make it that work better than what I've come up with, or just other little things that they do that, you know, that I haven't thought of yet. Okay, bye for now.